morning. My pie. We just ran into a little technological difficulties, but I think we're up and running. Let me just get the check upstairs. Are we on Facebook? Okay, that's all I need to hear. Good morning, Facebook and Tabor United Methodist Church. Happy Reformation Day. I know you might have been expecting something else, but we're going to talk about today. Reformation Sunday is bigger than anything you can think of. And we'll talk a lot about that today. But anyway, I want to come to you and give you a quote. Ask me what great things I know that delights and stirs me so. What high reward I win, whose name I glorify in Jesus Christ the Crucified. So again, thank you all for coming today. Happy October 31st. Lots of neat stuff going on today. And do you know, do you ever see that TV show? Maybe you remember it. It's kind of got a reboot. The Wonder Years? Yeah, and actually that little, I guess his name is Kevin Savage. He actually grew up and he rebooted it. Now, again, he's actually the producer for the new Wonder Years, but same idea, different culture, but an African-American version of it. But he is just, again, going back to those Wonder Years that you had. Well, I've been kind of experiencing the Wonder Years myself. I walk into a room, and I wonder why I walked into it. I wonder where my keys are. I wonder where my parking space is. Are you all in the Wonder Years, maybe? But the good news is we worship the God of wonders. It says the heavens declare his wonderfulness. So again, that's what we're here today to do, to just love God and praise him for his great name. Real quick, I got some announcements. Do you like announcements? All right, well, we're not going to make it too long, but we want to make sure everyone's up to date. Because there's a lot of great things happening. First of all, I want to thank you to everyone. Yesterday was a busy day for our church. And boy, we had Ken's memorial service there. We want to thank the family, Carol, for these wonderful flowers. And again, we have his pictures in the back. And in case you want one of the memorial service handouts, just a neat thing. So has Ken's obituary in there. And just what a wonderful day. So many of you just came in and brought food in, just saying, like, if this day's about Ken, we're going to just love on him and his family. And again, I love the family. They just made us feel like part of the family yesterday, and they were sharing all kinds of stories. And boy, you know why Ken is the way he is. What a special family. So, hey, and we got some special people here today. I want to thank them, the Damianis, or in the part of the family. They just did the history night. For Waxall, and she did a great job. So thank you for putting us on the map, making us part of Tabor history. So and thank you for coming, my neighbor, okay? And But again, we also love what the Historical Society is doing. Just a little news flash. Tabor United Methodist Church may be the largest indoor meeting place in Upper Salford. And as the Historical Society is doing such a great job of bringing our community together, getting our community excited about Upper Salford and Waxall, they're having a racing night with the Raymer family. Okay, that's my son. So the Raymer family is going to give a racing night, and you're like, what's that got to do with anything? Well, we're going to have the racing night. We're hosting the racing night here. So that's Monday, November 15th. We're going to have race cars out in the parking lot. Okay, so tell all your friends it's a Monday night, 7 o'clock, and my slant on this is I think God's at work here. I think God brought the idea together, is making it happen, having the community come to us. We always talk about going to the community. They're going to come here. We're going to have stuff set up going into the holiday season, showing them what we're going to be doing for Thanksgiving, showing them what we're going to be doing for Christmas. They're going to see it, and they're going to come to church. How about that? Is that for a plan? All right, so we're going to have race night. But again, invite anybody you want to race night. We want it to be a great event. And I'm thinking I'm going to hijack it for the following year. And we're going to have like a Christian race night the following year. So I don't want to take any glory away from the Historical Society. But we're going to take it and run with it, just as any race car fan would. What size did a 3/4 midget? Is it a history racing? But apparently, what I'm told from the history night, thank you again, is that Waxhaw has more champions from Grandview Raceway than any other town in the world. Which I said, of course we're the town of champions. Everyone knows that. All right. I'm getting carried away now, ain't I? Calm down, Pastor Ed. All right, well, let's get back on track. Next Sunday, turn your clocks back. Now, for most of you, it's not a problem because I think your smartphone does it automatically or whatnot. That's okay, but we're going to be falling back. So I don't know if that means if somebody's going to come in for Sunday school or miss it, whatever. You'll figure it out. And we'll send out a reminder. We have our giving app, the Vanco app. Again, just trying to make it easier for you to worship God in a giving way. God doesn't need our finances, but we want to honor God by blessing him so that he can share it. It's a part of our worship is the giving. So God has given so much to us. Can we give a percentage back? We're having chat room today. Resurrecting the chat room. That's going to be from 10 to 10:30. We have so much food left over from yesterday. We would love y'all to stay and please have some food. If you're watching at home, come on in. All right, so and maybe take some with you, all right? So I'm not sure how many of you all used to using your mailboxes. Cindy's been putting your Tabor Herald in there, so check your mailbox. But there's also something back there very timely for the day. That's all we'll say. So our Sunday school kids did that for you last week. So something from the Sunday school kids wanted to do for the rest of the church. Our adult Bible study is resuming today. Yes, it's right here around 10:30. It's going to be about worship. So again, if you want to join the other adults, just be back here at 10:30. Okay. Family fun time, woohoo, is continuing in Weller Hall. That's for all ages or all people. We have a different type of fun and worship. We have crafts and good stuff like that. So invite your neighbors, invite your enemies, okay? Maybe they won't be your enemies once they know Jesus Christ. So just throwing that out there. All right, now I got something for you. Are you on the next slide, Karen? Next slide, please. All right, I don't know if you know what you're seeing there. The mighty Tabor United Methodist bowling team. Fred Flintstone would be proud. Yes. We had to play the number one team on Tuesday night. And what do you do when you got to play the number one team? You go to your ringer, CF up there. Do you know who CF is up there? Cindy Frick broke her record, led the mighty Tabor team to victory with the high score for all of us. Yeah. And we won against the number one team, but we lost the next two games. But we won the first game. I think they fell apart. And then they did better, and then we fell apart in the last. But anyway, it was a lot of fun. And, you know, that's Cindy. Don't underestimate Cindy. The place was going crazy. Okay, anyway, on a more serious note, coming up Wednesday and Thursday is our June Russell blood drive. I heard Wednesday's already all filled up, perhaps. So maybe go online and try it, but you got to sign up online. Yeah, so Thursday, I think, still available. And we just love that there's so many people signing up to give blood. Because you know what? Jesus gave blood. You can't duplicate blood. Blood is the sign of life. So thank Jesus and thank you for giving blood. All right, real quick. Hey, is it too early for Thanksgiving? Well, the senior lunch in Thanksgiving, we got to sign up back there. That's going to be on the 10th. 10 days away, Marianne. Are we panicking? No way, because you all are going to help us all. It's going to be a great day. It always is a great luncheon. I'm just going to throw this out there. We're still in development. We're still going to get you some details. But we're going to have Thanksgiving dinner here on Thanksgiving. Karen's got it on her heart. She's been wanting to do this forever. And now that we're at a new church and a new, she's like, let's start it up. If you want to come for Thanksgiving, come. Her heart is that no one should be alone on Thanksgiving. So we're going to open the doors. Not that you have to be alone. You can bring your whole family. Just let us know if you're coming so we got enough stuffing and enough yams and cranberries and turkey, of course. Okay, so that's going to be on Thanksgiving. I got to get back to you with the time. We're still fighting over it, but you let us know what time works for you. All right, but that's on Thanksgiving. Right here, we're going to have Thanksgiving dinner. All right, what else is here? We talked about race night. Hanging of the Greens, the 21st. That's like 3 weeks, I think. After the service, this before Thanksgiving, we're going to decorate because the following Sunday is Advent. Merry Christmas, everybody. We're going to be doing Christmas right here at table. And you know how beautiful the church is, but we need your help. We can't do it alone, and God didn't mean us to do it alone. And we're going to have a luncheon afterwards for that, and we're going to have some tomfoolery going on during lunch, some fun festivities for the holidays. Okay, so please come out for the Hanging of the Greens. That'll be after the worship service. And we're starting our Christmas shoe boxes. Pretty good, huh? Yeah, now there's Christmas shoe boxes. The materials are out there. There's shoe boxes out there. I hope you know how this works. We need the shoe boxes back in 3 weeks, the same day as the Hanging of the Greens, the 21st, the Sunday before Thanksgiving, because we got to get it out to people. So it's a lot of logistics to get those shoe boxes where they need to go. So again, if you have any questions, the materials are back there. We'll also include that in our email. Are there any other announcements? Okay. Well, of course. Cindy keeps me honest. Cindy's got that Tabor Herald memorized. Okay.
So that would be November 28th, and we're asking for donations of fresh baked goods, you know, cookies, brownies, whatever, store purchase, individually wrapped items that can be put in new goodie boxes for the students. So there will be a total of, I believe, 16 boxes we'll be doing. Because
awesome.
We also include our military.
Yeah, nice.
And if you would like to just make a donation,
right,
you could do that to the church and just earmark it that it's for United Methodist student goodie boxes. Or you could purchase like a $10 gift card,
yep,
to Wawa, Starbucks, Walmart, Target. Those are some of the Dunkin' Donuts.
This is what the cool college kids like. That reminds me, mark your calendars, not just show up every Sunday, but I believe in 2 weeks, we're going to have our dedication of the sleeping bags for the homeless. So you want to come in, or we can't even get it in one shot. There's so many sleeping bags for the homeless that we're going to be taking down to the homeless soon. So that's, I believe, in 2 weeks. Any other announcements? Are we good on sound? Just a, what's the
problem?
What's that? Oh, no, okay, well, I'll change the batteries out. Okay. All right, well, thanks for that. For those that couldn't hear Cindy online, student recognition is coming up right around Thanksgiving. We'll get you the dates out. But she was saying we need donations of goodies or gift cards. Okay? Any other announcements? Did you come here to worship God? Are you ready to worship God? Is there anyone here who will call us to worship? Mary Ann, will you call us to worship, please?
It'd be tough to beat that act.
Oh.
Please join me in the call to worship. Your steadfast love, O Lord. Your faithfulness to the clouds. Your judgments are like the great deep. Please join in our opening hymn, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, number 64. Let us pray. Lord God, your love and care for us is immeasurable. If we really think about it, we can't even begin to measure the way you continue to love us, care for us, and make yourself known to us. Reveal yourself to each one here this morning or watching online so that we all can have a greater understanding of who you are and how much you love us and want to be in relationship with us. Thank you that you are always with us no matter what we are going through. And we just know that you want us to trust you. Give us a greater understanding of what trusting you means and look like as we worship you together. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Marianne. Boy, you guys sound great. Are you all in the choir? Man, that was awesome. Thank you, Joanne. You are playing some great keys there. So thank you for that. And also we want to thank Joanne for our wonderful graphics that she has every week. She does a great job with that and providing us with a visual stimulating service. So, hey kids, are you excited? I can tell. Yeah, we're having a lot of fun, aren't we? Well, today, you might know today is Halloween. And I just wanted to give you a little fun fact about Halloween that you might not have known about. Halloween is a word that's derived, that means it came from a bigger word that was All Hallows Eve. Just like there's Christmas Eve, Christmas Eve is the day before Christmas. So All Hallows Eve, and that's kind of where we get the word, if you crump it together or say it, All Halloween, Hallows Eve, that's, now hollow, that's a weird word. That doesn't mean like there's nothing inside. Hollow, think of when we say our Father who art in heaven, hollow, not hollow, but hollow. And that word means like holy or sacred. So back in the day, back when they were celebrating a sinful day on October 31st, people were doing sinful things. The church thought, let's do like Jesus does. Let's take what's sinful and try to make it holy. That's what Jesus did. So we're going to take this sinful day and make it holy. So they made November 1st All Hallows Day. We might know that as All Saints Day, hollow and saint and sacred and holy. They all kind of mean the same thing. So the day before All Saints Day or All Hallows Day was Halloween. So that's where we get that from. So it's actually an attempt to take something that was not nice and make it better. Now, I told everyone earlier, maybe you heard me, that today is also Reformation Day. And you're like, I never heard of that. But actually, Reformation Day is perhaps one of the biggest and most important days. You're like, well, then how come I never heard about it? We want to let you know about Reformation Day. Reformation Day is kind of like God, just like he formed man or Adam, God also formed a way for us to get to heaven. Just like I'm forming with this Play-Doh, and you'd play with Play-Doh, and so I'm going to do a real quick thing here where God formed a way for us to get to heaven. And that way for us to get to heaven was that he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for our sins so that when we believe and trust in Jesus as our Lord and Savior, knowing that he died on the cross and rose again, knowing that he's the Son of God, that's how we would get to heaven. And that's what the Bible teaches. But people, over years, they started adding other things to the way to get to heaven. They said, you got to do good things. They said, you got to do all these other things. And before you knew it, they added to what God had formed. And somebody by the name of Martin Luther came along, and others, he wasn't the first, but he's more famous, and said, that's not right. You can't add to the way to get to heaven. So we had people that said, we need to get back and reform what everyone messed up over many years and get back. So that's what Reformation is called. It's called reforming, getting back to the way God intended for how we are to get to heaven. And it's by Jesus Christ alone. We don't add doing anything else to that. Jesus Christ paid for it all and did it all, and that's all we need to do, okay? So I just want you to remember, every time you have a Halloween, remember there's a much bigger day than Halloween. It's on the same day. And adults, we'll talk about it. It's no accident. It's no coincidence. So we'll talk about that in a little bit. But it's Reformation Day. It's a day when we figured out, how do we get to heaven? How does God tell us to get to heaven? So let's pray for our kids. God, thank you for taking a day when people are sinning and making it holy, just like you did with us. You took our sins through Jesus' death and made us holy. So we thank you for that, God. And God, we thank you for our children, and we thank you for Reformation Sunday and all the wonderful people who got your message back to the way it was meant to be. Lord, please bless our children. Watch over them and keep them safe. Let them know that they don't have to be afraid. They don't have to be scared. That we have faith, and that wherever there's darkness, there is the light of God. And we will love God and praise God. Amen. All right, well, is there any other bigger kids in the house? Well, we have a special, just a little, another fun fact. Do you like fun facts? We'll try to keep it short because we don't want to cut into chat time, right? Nah, just kidding. Today's an easy lesson. It's a fun lesson. For our United Methodist Church, if you go back 250 years ago, at the time of John Wesley and all, right now we're experiencing when John Wesley, 250 years ago, sent his first American bishop to, it's not even the United States yet, it's the colonies. Let me see if I can get the date on it. I want to say 1770-something, 71, I'm thinking, that he sends, 1771, John Wesley over in England sends Francis Asbury to Philadelphia to be the first bishop and to organize this Methodism that's developing. So again, just another little fun fact that's going on in this timeline. If you want to talk about Reformation Day, and if you like dates, and hello, here in the United States in a couple years, we're going to be celebrating 250 years. Now, a lot of you are saying, like, we just celebrate the bicentennial a couple years ago. I was there. But anyway, we're looking at the next two. Somehow 50 years went by. I know. But anyway, for you that like dates, Reformation Sunday. So we have Martin Luther. That was almost 500 years ago. It's actually 500, let me see, I did, and 4 years ago. He did it on 1517. So 4 years ago, it was a big deal because that was the 500th anniversary of Martin Luther and what he did. And we'll talk about that in a second here. Well, let's get into it. So you all know about, perhaps, I'm hoping you know about Martin Luther. If not, Google him. 500 years ago, we were answering a big question about how do you get to heaven? How do we follow God? Who's in charge of the church? All these are big questions. As we talked about the kids, things kind of got out of shape over the years. So as we come back to it, the church at the time of Martin Luther, around the age of 1500, lots of power. And that's sometimes a good thing, but sometimes when there's lots of power, it can be misused. And the church was misusing their power. There was corruption because power corrupts if there's not accountability. And there wasn't enough accountability. There's abuse of power. There's people with doing money grabs. There's all kinds of nonsense going on in the church. Now, there's good people in the church, and Martin Luther was one of them. He's going through the system. He's a professor of theology. And he's, like, realizing that, you know, some of these things just aren't right. That he wants to, you know, it's just, at the time, and maybe some of you all remember this. Where's my Catholics, my former Catholics? Do you remember going to church? And it was in Latin. Okay, now you're a little older, but right, and you're like, are you kidding me? I think up into the late 60s, I think after Vatican II, they finally started making the Catholic Church, the Mass, in English. It used to be in Latin, from what I understand. Now, if somebody correct me, that's fine. But going way back then, in Martin Luther's time, it wasn't in the native language. And that's the problem, because the church just saying, trust us what it says. And no one can read the scripture because they weren't educated enough and to question what was being said. Well, okay, so from that part, that's kind of how the church got off track. And Martin Luther shows up, professor of theology, pretty sharp dude, an interesting guy, very sincere, wanting to have a honest debate, trying to show the church, well, surely if they see, if I explain to them how we got off track here, show them what the scriptures say, surely they will recognize and let's get back to the way it was. Let's reform it. Let's fix it. That's all he wanted to do. So what does he do? Well, on October 31st, now don't try that today because we have glass doors. He nailed it to the door of the church. And that seems like such a strange thing now. His 95 thesis, his 95 questions. And anybody, you have a question, you ask it. There is no question that you shouldn't be able to ask. And there are some tough questions. God, why are there mosquitoes? But anyway, there's other theological questions that we can answer for you or to get an answer for you. But always ask a question. But again, that's all he wanted to have that where he thought, like, surely we can figure this out. Let's get things back to the scriptures. And so he picked a day. He hanged them up on October 31st, knowing the next day was All Saints Day, All Hallows Day, knowing the church would be packed. And it wasn't strange back then to nail things to the church door. That would be like posting it on the internet today. Like, let's talk about this. And people would see about it and like, oh. So he was just trying to get people's attention. And he got their attention. Again, just a wild thing. Now, I'm going to give you a little background. And some of my Catholic people, we're recovering Catholics. And I kid a lot with the Catholics. I got a lot of Catholics praying for me, okay? So I love the Catholics. And they're part of our heritage, so everything's tongue-in-cheek, okay? But here's a real thing. There's two type of sins, according to Catholic theology, and that was the theology at the time. There's venial sin. Now, that's a minor offense, according to the church at the time. It's a slight sin that does not cause damnation of the soul. Say if you lost your patience, that would be a venial sin. It didn't deprive your soul of the sanctifying grace that was allowed to you. Okay, so you have venial sin, a slight sin. And then they would categorize the more serious sin, mortal sin. And that word mortal sounds pretty serious, and it was. Because for the church, a mortal sin was a sin that you committed with a full knowledge and full consent that you had a free will to do it, and you did it. You knew that it was a sin, and you did it anyway. It was premeditated. And these are more serious sins, like murder, like rape, like lying or perjury, like adultery or fornication. Back in my day, and I think it still holds up, we were told anything against the Ten Commandments was a mortal sin. Now, for us in the Ten Commandments, you had to keep the Lord's Day holy. So for Catholics, you wonder why their churches are always packed. Because if they don't go to church, a mortal sin is a sin that can cause you eternal damnation if you don't repent of it. That sounds like serious stuff. Now, we treat sin as sin. And I think Jesus was clear about that. He said, if you get angry at your neighbor, that's like committing murder. So Jesus is kind of raising the bar and like, whoa. But his point was, let's deal with sin. Sin is serious. You know, if I control my anger, maybe I won't get road rage. All right? A real thing. And has road rage led to some people dying? Yes, it has. So what Jesus said makes sense. Let's check ourselves before we wreck ourselves. Let's not treat any sin like that's just a little sin. I just do a little gossip. That's just a little sin. No, that sin has serious implications. And if you want to look at it, all sin is serious because sin is what put Jesus on the cross. Jesus died for sin, so no sin is small. But anyway, to get back to our part about these different types of sins, and so let's follow up. How many of you ever heard of purgatory? Yeah, this is very popular today. And a little fun fact. And again, it's just interesting things. Martin Luther believed in purgatory. But again, there's just this, because most people did it that day. Now, we don't believe in purgatory as Protestants, okay? Catholics believe in that. But here's the belief of the time and still today. If you died with no sins, anybody here? And that's my point. But there was, in their opinion, if you died without sin, I think that's a sin to even say that. If you died without sin, you would go to heaven. Well, yes, you would. But I don't know how many people that fall into that group. I know I do not. If you died with a mortal sin, you know, one of those big ones, you went to hell. Okay, well, if you died with a venial sin, one of the lesser sins, then you went to purgatory, and there was a purifying fire. Now, there was debate to whether that was just symbolic or whatnot, but that would, you suffered in purgatory until you did your time of suffering, and then you could go to heaven. And most people felt that they fell into that group. Okay, I'm probably going to purgatory because I didn't murder anybody today, and if I die today. But Martin Luther, and I would agree with Martin Luther, he was not okay with this system. He knew he was a sinful man, just like Paul said. Paul said, I am the greatest sinner of all, because the closer you get to the light, the more you see your dirt. And that's what Paul saw, that he said, I'm the chief sinner of all. And Martin Luther knew he was a sinner. He would go to confession for hours every day. And they're like, Martin, you gotta stop. And he'd come out of confession, you're like, I feel so good, I feel so clean. I'm going to heaven. And he knew, just as I know, just as perhaps you know, just my thoughts alone condemn me. I don't have to kill anybody. I killed them in my brain, and that's a sin. I didn't curse with my mouth, but I cursed in my mind, and that's a sin. So Martin Luther knew that he was a damned man, and he couldn't live with that. And he was just fearful of going to hell and the judgment of God. And he did, because here's also the system. And we would differ from the system of that day, kind of like we said they reformed. The church at that point had added to the cross. They said you had to do certain things to get to heaven. You had to do good works to get to heaven. Now, us as Protestants, we're not against good works, but we're very careful to say it is not the cross plus good works. It's not Jesus and good works that get you to heaven. It's Jesus that gets you to heaven. And then my heart is so warmed. I'm so loved because I've got the forgiveness of God. I feel the mercy and grace that I want to go and do good things. And that's the way we feel the Bible intended it. Well, first of all, I just want to get just that, you know, I'm always telling my mom this one. And mom, if you're watching, I don't apologize. I want you to hear this. I want all Catholics to hear this. And I say this with love and respect. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. And we don't have it on the slide here, but I know a lot of you all have it memorized. And if you don't, please do. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. Again, speaking to people that believe, I'm going to get to heaven because I do good things, because I give a church. Now, you should give a church, but don't give a church thinking that that's going to get you to heaven. Help other people. We're doing a lot of help with the poor and our shoeboxes and other things. But don't do that hoping that you're going to get to heaven, okay? Now, we do those things because, well, let me give you Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. For it is by grace that you have been saved. Yes, grace alone. Through faith. And this is not from yourselves. And the verse 9 is, not by works. We don't get to heaven by doing things. We get to heaven by what Jesus did. Now again, some of my friends would say, well, what about James 4? Where it says, your faith without works is dead, Pastor Ed. And I get that. I agree with you. Faith without works is dead. But works is not part of the equation. Works is after the equation. We do works. Our works are the fruit of our salvation. James is saying, if I don't see your fruit, I'm questioning your faith. Because he's saying that your faith is dead if I'm not seeing fruit of it. Your works are the evidence. It is the proof of what you believe. And we don't do it to get saved. We do it because we are saved. Okay, so I know that you might see there's a fine line there, but it's not. It's a black and white issue, and that's why I want to make a big deal out of it on this Reformation Sunday. So again, there's another little problem that Martin Luther has that's going on at this time. Indulgences. Okay, as we talked about purgatory, if you knew somebody in purgatory, which I don't know how you would know that, but You know, and I used to pray for my grandpop. I thought grandpop would be, he didn't kill anybody. I didn't think he stole anything. I thought he's in purgatory. So I would pray for Pop to get out of purgatory. And we were taught if you pray for that, you can shorten his time in purgatory. Or if you did good things, you could shorten somebody's time. These were called indulgences. Now, the church at that time took it to a horrible length, a terrible length. And they said, you could pay money because we're building the St. Peter's Basilica down in Rome, and we need some money, and you could pay some money and maybe not go to purgatory yourself or for a loved one that's already there. And Luther almost lost it when he heard about this. And he was like, this just blew. This is what really prompted the final straw. And Luther's like saying, no way, no way. And I want to go to a couple scriptures for you, just to, again, before we get too far, we want to always ground this all in scriptures. He's a professor of theology, Martin Luther. Martin Luther specializes in certain books. He writes big study notes on the book of Romans. And in Romans, he discovers this great fact that frees him. And it's what we usually say all the time. He's in first Romans chapter 5, verse 1, he discovered, it was maybe missed, maybe misunderstood, but it's there. It's all through the Bible. But again, sometimes a light bulb's got to go off. It says in Romans chapter 5, verse 1, and this is after reading the first four chapters, he finally says, beginning in chapter 5, therefore, we have been justified. Let me just make sure I get the right version here. Therefore, since we have been justified, made right by God, okay? Justified through what? Faith. Faith in what? Jesus Christ. By grace, okay? Faith, we have peace with God, and that's what we need. We need to have peace with God because our sin has separated us from God. We have been justified through faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And read more of Romans. It's all throughout it. As a lot of people would say, like, well, I don't know. Is that just New Testament? And Martin Luther would say, no. And he used Abram back then as the proof that Abram, the father of our faith for the Jewish people and for others, he says, Abraham, it says in Genesis chapter 15, verse 6, Abram believed the Lord. And guess what? The Lord credited to him as righteousness. Now, Abraham did a lot of things, and a lot of the Jewish people thought that that's what made him right with God. But then Luther said, no, look, right in Genesis, it says he first believed the Lord, and it was credited to him as righteousness. I want to throw another one at you. And again, there's these all through the Bible, but I like threes. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 38. We don't have it on the slide, but it says, and this is the famous quote that you'll often hear Luther say, now the just, or the righteous, shall live by faith. All right, so that's how we're to live, by faith. And that's what he would cling to, and that's what he was hoping for, and that's what he was fighting for, that we would live by faith. So as Luther's doing that, there's another part, again, that he wants salvation by faith alone, and there's a trial, we won't get into all the mix of it. Maybe we show it as a movie night sometime. He then goes on to write the scriptures in German for his German people so that they could see what he's saying, so that they could understand it. This hasn't been done before, and this is the same time we have the press going on. He's also saying, where do we get what we know? Now, in that time and to now, and with all due respect, you know, I love the man, but the Pope can speak on God's behalf, okay? So the Pope, every once in a while, can say something about Mary. Well, the Pope can say something about this is now a holy day. And the Pope was dictating from God. And Martin Luther said, the problem with that is we're all infallible. We're only human. And Pope, I'm sure you're smart, but he said, we got to get it all from the Bible. The Bible, Jesus alone, and the Bible alone, Scripture alone. faith alone. And that's what Martin Luther was saying. Now, to be fair, all right, so since I'm poking a lot of people, let's be fair, because Martin Luther almost proved, he proves his own point. Martin Luther's doing great and being awesome, and everyone's like, yay, Martin. And as time goes on, a lot of people, as Martin suffers from old age, as Martin gets older and he's having chronic pain, Martin starts saying some embarrassing things. Again, he's only human. He's not declaring, he's sharing what he thinks. He thinks the end of the world's going to happen any day. And maybe it will. But it didn't happen then. So Martin Luther embarrassingly says, all the Jewish people should be burned. You know, and we can't deny that. And he said it. It's not a myth or anything. But then again, to me, he's proven his own point. We don't venerate Martin Luther. We don't make him a... He's a human. He's fallible, too. He has some great points and great things. And people would still debate things he said. And again, just a little more fun facts. What we do on the first of the month with Eucharist is often debated. And again, to my Catholic friends, I love you. Please don't take any of this. That the Eucharist, we debate. Jesus said, this is my body. And is that actually Jesus' body is the debate? Or is it something else? Is it symbolic, as many Protestants believe? I believe the method says there's something else special going on. So I don't want to give us a clear definition. My take on it, anybody that says they know what's going on during communion, definitively, it's a mystery, right? I don't know how you could. But anyway, Martin Luther actually believed, as the Catholics do, that this is actually the body and blood of Jesus Christ. So a lot of people believe he was doing the symbolic thing, as Lutherans, I think, believe now. But that came with Zwingli, who he had fights with later. Again, proving that he had his moment in time, but others then came up. So anyway, as we finish out, I just want to give some good news. The Catholic Church doesn't remain there. They have the Council of Trent. And thank God for the Jesuit priests. The Jesuit priests, who are great missionaries and great educators, they come up, and through the Council of Trent, they start to reform the Catholic Church inside the Catholic Church, which is only what Martin Luther wanted to do. They pulled back a lot of the abuses, a lot of the power, wrong things, a lot of the big payments, and a lot of those things. So the Catholic Church, as we know it, is thankful to a lot of the Jesuits who, way back when, kind of got reformed the church themselves. Now, again, not exactly as we have it, but again, took away some of those, took away the indulgences as we described them. That stopped, and other atrocities. I'm going to finish on this note, just as we talk about, because it seems like we're talking about something so long ago, that could never happen now. And I think it's just human nature that we want to do something to earn our salvation. And God says, hello, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, Jesus Christ, that whoever believed, not do work, will have, not perish and have everlasting life. And he said, he gave it. It's a gift. You can't earn a gift. But we want to, as humans. We're like, I'm uncomfortable with getting a gift. It's going to happen at Christmas. People are going to be nice and give me things. I'm like, here. Or I'm going to do something nice for you. And it's just, the right response is, thank you. But my pride goes against that, and we got to get away from that. So anyway, fast forward to what we started talking about, John Wesley, Methodism. He has these methods, great spiritual methods, prayer, meeting together, doing all these wonderful things, visiting prisoners. But he would tell you himself, he thought that that's what made him righteous. And then come one day, Aldersgate, he's studying, guess what? Martin Luther's notes on Romans. And John Wesley says, I was strangely warmed when he discovered the true gospel, that it's not by doing works, that it's by faith alone in Jesus Christ. And then John Wesley's life is changed from that point on with the power of the Holy Spirit, and he changed the world. And that's what I believe, and what do you believe? Do you believe in God? Do you believe in God the Father? Marianne, could you help us with what we believe?
Please join me in affirming our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please join in the hymn, I Need Thee Every Hour, number 397. This is the time in our service where we have an opportunity to share with one another any prayer concerns that we might have or to give testimony as to the ways we've seen God moving in our lives. If you have any prayer concerns or testimonies, just raise your hand and Jack will bring the mic to you. I just like to remind everybody to keep in prayer. We have people in our church and friends of our church that are still in the process of grieving, so prayer for them. We also have members and friends of our church that are going through cancer and cancer treatment, so we just need to keep praying for them. And also, it just seems like we also have people with heart issues, so we have a lot going on, and so we obviously need God's peace and healing on people's lives. Does anybody else have any prayer concerns or specific concerns that they would like to share this morning?
I don't know who it was.
Liz.
Liz, okay. Yesterday I was sitting near her and saw her run out because she had her phone in her hand, but the way she ran out, I thought she was experiencing a heart issue. And so I got up and went out to her and asked what I can do. Is she all right? And she said she had just received a phone call that her father-in-law passed away while shopping, and it just really overwrought her. And so I think we need to keep her in prayer, because what are the odds that you'd be attending someone else's funeral and service and it happens, you know? So keep her in prayer, please.
Any others?
So we heard back from the team at Penn, and Paul will need surgery, but the good news is they feel they can do a partial, so a resection. We do not have a surgery date yet, probably sometime this month. It will be a 5 to 10 day stay in the hospital because it'll be very complicated, because my husband's complicated. No, I'm only kidding. I love him. But aren't we all? Yeah. And just prayers as the team prepares what to do. As I said, the Dr. Rosado, who will be operating on him, his uncle did the surgery in 96, his other colon surgery. So he's in very good hands. So he'll talk to his oncologist on Monday, and hopefully we'll have more information and maybe a date. So.
Prayers for my brother, Mark. He's down to 102 pounds. We didn't know why. And the dentist found a very suspicious growth in his mouth. So he's being biopsied in the coming weeks. My brother has a brain injury, so this is very scary for him. So please remember him.
I'd ask you to lift up Vicki as she goes through all this, too. She's going to be stuck making all those decisions. Not all of them, but the big ones, anyway.
Any others? All right. Let us go before the Lord. Lord God, we thank you for your presence here this morning and in our lives. And we know that there's many in our church and people that we know around our church that are going through so many issues. And so we lift them before you now. Lord, we pray for those grieving, still walking through that time of grieving. Lord, we especially think of Carol as we had the service for Ken yesterday. And Lord, we just ask that you would just surround all those that are struggling with the loss of loved ones, that you would surround them with your peace and your love, that they would be reminded of your presence and just provide them the comfort that they need as they walk through these times and missing the ones that they love. Remind them, Lord, of the love that you have for them and that the care that you now are giving to their loved ones. And so, Lord, help that to be just something that would give them peace and comfort at this time. Lord, we also lift up those that are walking through cancer, cancer treatments and the diagnosis of cancer and surgeries coming up, and we just lift them up before you, Lord. We think of Becca and Mary and also Paul. Lord, we ask that you would be with each one of them, that they would just sense your presence in the midst of what they are going through and the diagnosis that they have. We pray for the upcoming surgery for Paul, and that you would be with the surgeons and the team, that they would know exactly what they need to do and that all would go well. Lord, we also know that you are a God who heals, and so, Lord, obviously our first concern for all of them is that you would provide healing for them, even if it's through just minimal treatment, Lord, that the doctors would be amazed at the healing that has taken place in their lives, that the cancer would be gone. So, Lord, we lift them all into your care and just ask that you would continue to be with them. And we just ask that you would be with their family members as they watch their loved ones going through this. Lord, we also lift up those that have been having heart issues. The heart is either beating too fast or too slow. And Lord, some have gone through treatment that hasn't worked, and some will be going through treatment. And so, Lord, we just lift them before you and pray that you would do what is right for each one of those, Lord, that especially that they would have peace from you, knowing that they are in your hands and that they can trust you with whatever has to happen. Lord, we also lift up Liz to you as she goes through finding out her father-in-law died suddenly, and just ask that you would surround her and her family, again, with your peace and comfort as they walk through that time. And Lord, we lift up Mark to you, and we pray that whatever they found is not any kind of cancer, but it'll be something that can be treated easily, and we pray peace over Mark as he tries to figure out what's going on and not fully understanding, and just ask that you would be with him. Also, we lift up Vicky to you and just ask that you would give her the wisdom that she needs to make decisions on his behalf, and that she can encourage him and that he can trust her with whatever that she is saying to him, that everything will be okay. So, Lord, we just lift up that whole situation to you. Lord, we also lift up the leadership of our church and ask that you would continue to give us the wisdom and knowledge that we need to be the church that you are calling us to be, not only in this building, but out in our community as well. And if there are those in our community who we recognize as needing your love and assistance or whatever, Lord, that you might bring those people to mind, and that we might, as a church, be able to help them and just be able to share your love with our community and all that you're doing in people's lives and how much you love them. So, Lord, again, thank you for who you are and the ways that you have been providing for our church. And we just ask that you would continue to bless the church and the people and your people as we continue to do your work. We ask all of this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As Ed mentioned in the announcements, we now have an app for giving to the church, but you can also still send in checks to the church office, and there's also plates at the back of the sanctuary. And again, we just thank all of you who have been faithful in your giving, especially through this pandemic, and we just ask that a blessing over all of you for the ways that you continue to provide for our needs. And so as part of that, we will sing just how thankful we are for the blessings that God has given us.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord, we are thankful for your people and the ways that they continue to provide for our church, not only monetarily, but also in service to our church. We just ask that you bless them, whether they come here in person or continue to give online, even though they've been watching on Facebook. Lord, we just ask your blessing upon all of them that have been providing and helping out in the church. And we just ask that what has been done, not only the service, but the money that has been given may be used to bless others in our community and throughout the world. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please join in our closing hymn, number 467, Trust and Obey. About you, but I've always found it freeing to know that there's, you know, I don't have to do 1,000 things or always be at work for God in order to get into heaven. And it's right, it's just because of our relationship with Him that we want to serve Him. So I pray that you this week will also feel free to know that, you know, there is an opportunity for all of us to go to be with Him, and it's not by what we do. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you that you sent your Son to die on the cross for us, and that having a relationship with you and believing in you is the way that we need to get to heaven. And so, Lord, we just pray that you would also just this week help us to feel free that we, you know, haven't done enough or whatever we might be thinking, that we are free from those thoughts, that you should take them captive. And Lord, and bring them to the truth of what your word says. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week.